Welcome.
Welcome to the Car Merchant Nelson YouTube channel.
Yeah, oh my god. What are we doing?
It's long time coming, I think. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, welcome. This is the official channel for our store, our wonderful little LGS in Nelson, New Zealand. On 129 Hardy Street. We've been open 2 years pretty much this week. And yeah, we just thought it was about time to, well, you've become very skillful in the art of making videos.
Making videos, why not?
And we just thought, you know, it was time to pour our efforts and passion of playing all the time into creating content for a wide range of games that we have in store and that we run events for. And, you know, exciting new games such as this debut Grand Archive,
which came out not too long ago, actually.
Well, officially releasing end of April, but
yeah, it's not even out.
We've got our hands on recently. Kickstarter, exactly. And we've gone pretty hard. We've got probably a dozen plus in Nelson building decks and playing around, which is nice. And yeah, it's a very fun game. Different crossovers and bits and bobs from other games, as most are these days, but really cool artwork, nice themes with elements. You got your wizards and warriors and all those cool things. They say it's based off Arthurian legend and
lore. There's a lot of references to Camelot and Arthur and Merlin and all that. It's an anime
with a
story with a western
gameplay design. So yeah, I mean, we'll kind of walk through our plays, I guess, try and be quite vocal about what's going on, but the main fundamentals is you have a material deck which is inclusive of your champion, who has your life total and has special abilities, and they can level up from 0, 1, 2, and max at the moment 3. And the cost of this is different to the cost of your main deck. So playing cards from your hand in your main deck, you put that many cards as the cost face down into your memory zone.
Yeah.
And then for your material, which is you can play one per turn maximum from there at the start of the turn phases, you pay the cost of that as a number of cards equal to the cost at random get banished from your face down memory pile that you'd put there from playing stuff the turn before or at instant speed somewhere in between. So yeah, it's got fast spells and slow spells, so instants and sorceries,
interaction on both players' turns.
And you've got allies, which are a bit like creatures, I guess, from Magic,
monsters,
from Yu-Gi-Oh. They can attack the first turn they come in, and they can attack direct to another ally on their side or to their champion.
If you attack
an ally, what happens, Jess?
Attack an ally, they can choose to retaliate with that ally.
If it's
awake.
Yeah.
Say I've got this highwayman and I'm being attacked by another highwayman.
Yeah.
So my highwayman, which rests to attack, targeting this, my highwayman can then tap itself as well and deal its attack damage to the other ally.
And if his had attacked last turn and was rested, and then I played this and I attack into his rested ally, it can't retaliate.
Yeah.
And so mine's safe from damage.
Yeah.
And then with the champions, some are more attack based than others. The
certain mages cards that you attack with champions.
Yeah, the mages don't do as much attacking from their own, you know, themselves. But the likes of Lorraine or Zander, sometimes assassin and warrior, they can attack with weapons which come out of here from the material, or with attack cards. So yeah, enough blibbity blabbity blubbity, but yeah, we're hoping to bring more gameplay. We want to do some learn to play kind of intro-y to game for new people coming across the website and stuff. You know, for all the games, Yu-Gi-Oh, Pokemon, Magic.
Yeah, try and do a bit of that.
Yep, and then just some gameplay of, you know, games at the time, fun deck ideas.
Yeah.
Keep it fairly intermediary, like in the middle, sort of not too hardcore competitive and maybe not too basic. You know, once we've got the initial learn to play of each game up.
Yeah.
And we'll also do, you know, at times we'll do some pack openings, and maybe even like deck techs or spicy budget brews and stuff. For,
yeah.
You know, because obviously people who are into games or wanting to get into games, it's a wide spectrum, right? Some
yeah.
people have big budgets, some people don't, some people have lots of time, some people don't. So we want to cater to all these different things as we move along. And of course, because it's the Card Merchant Nelson channel, it'll be a lot easier to, you know, plug and let you guys know when there's a sale on or pre-orders are up for a thing or
yeah.
that kind of stuff as well. So should be good. Please like and subscribe and tell your friends that we are here. Yeah. So yeah. I guess starting wise, this, what, you have an 80 card
list? 80 cards in total.
Yep.
And 60 cards
minimum
to submit for each game.
For your deck.
Yep.
And then 12 exact.
12, for your material exactly pile. 12 material cards. Yep. So that means you've got 8 sideboard cards left over for, because it's a best of 3 game, so
yep.
for round games 2 and 3 you get to bring in some more effective cards that you might want.
Yep. I guess we may as well.
Do you want to sort of slowly describe your deck a little bit before we jump in, or just figure it out as we go?
Yep, I've got to quickly take out 8 cards. So you have to start with a set first game list as well.
Yeah.
So with explaining this 8 spare cards, you have to decide what not playing in a first game.
I guess while you're doing that, I'll explain what my deck does.
Sounds good.
So I'm playing a water deck, and the hero I've chosen is Zander, which is an assassin. So he's all about doing lots of little points of damage and getting in attacks and attacking sometimes multiple times a turn. He's got his level up to 3. He's got the Luxem element. So when you play heroes with elements, it lets you play cards of that element. So because you always start with a level 0 spirit card. So I'm starting with water, which means my deck will be mostly water cards. You can also play Norm cards that can go in any deck.
So colorless from Magic or artifacts, colorless. Or from Fab as generics.
Yeah, sort of equivalent to that. So this deck basically wants to get to level 3 Zander as fast as possible and start abusing his ability, which says at the beginning of your recollection phase, which is when you pick your memory up into your hand for the start of turn, you reveal all cards in your memory, and for each Luxem element revealed this way, each opponent puts a card from their hand into their memory. So that can probably turn off a lot of instant speed stuff, shenanigans that'll annoy you on your turn, so you're free to do whatever you want. And a lot of Luxem cards have effects if they get revealed from memory. So the main ones we have here, there's a few others, but this deck's mainly running Luxem Sight. Whenever it is revealed from memory, gain 3 life.
Well, recover 3. So the way that's it, while we're here, so damage in this game, this is our life totals.
Life totals.
But because you evolve up levels, the damage goes on. So damage counters build up.
Yeah. And once you reach, which is why we're starting at 0, you can see on the screen.
Yeah.
But so yeah, you usually start with 15. So, and as you level up, you generally gain 3 to 4 life total maximum.
Yeah.
So 19, 22, 25. And once you hit that number on the damage counter, you go, you die.
And I've really liked how James put it the other week that, you know, as different to life gain or being able to go to like 100 life, this sort of relative mechanic of recover in this game is taking off that many damage counters, so you can never go below, you know,
you can never go above your zero maximum
damage. So it's that's quite good, I think, too.
Yeah.
It keeps the game a bit more, well, just eliminates one derpy element of these
games. I mean, if this deck could gain more than its maximum, it would be pretty broken.
Yeah, it would be silly.
Because this deck can generally gain, if it's doing the right thing, 6 life a turn.
Yeah.
So, which is a lot in this game, because most attacks are for 2 or 3 each.
Sorry to interrupt on that one, but that was good to cover. And what is this one?
Lux, like Lightweaver's Assault. Well, that's the main... This is part of the win condition of this deck. This one says whenever you reveal it from memory, choose a unit and deal 2 damage to it. So that could be a champion or it could be an ally.
Yep.
So essentially 2 damage every turn, unpreventable generally. Yep. Well, some things can, but not many. And yeah, imagine if you had 2 or 3 of those in your memory every turn. That builds up pretty fast. So
yeah,
that is the main aim of this deck, is to get lots of these in memory and start shooting things. Gleaming Cut also lets you draw 2 cards when you reveal it, which is pretty broken as well.
Yeah, draw cards at quite a premium in this game.
Yeah, when your cards in hand are your resources, it's pretty good to draw lots of cards.
Yeah, and there's not a ton of drawing lots of cards, but I guess that's a good segue onto the basics of my deck.
Yeah.
So we've been mucking around. There are some online results and things from, you know, people getting into the game. And Lorraine, who's the main warrior chick champion, she's been doing really well with Wind Element and I think Fire pretty well as well.
Yeah, Fire's pretty good.
So we're not playing her because you could probably find as much info on her anyway. But naturally, I always like to go off the beaten track and just, you know, especially when a game's new. Like for me, this is really exciting to get creative and just try out every card that exists in this first set and see what, you know, what I guess what the devs and what the company, you know, were aiming for with this game and the set that they've created. So there's 4 main champions or sort of like level ups, but they made an alternative set of 4 in the same classes. So there's a mage wizard and another assassin, another tamer and another warrior. But that are just at level 2, and you can level them up onto any level 1 champion that you have in play already. So this deck has got Merlin, who's a mage, and we didn't cover it yet, but you'll see in the game, I guess, there's a mechanic called floating memory. So cards that have floating memory on them in the text box, they can be banished if they're in your graveyard to pay for the costs or one of the costs towards something you materialize out of this side deck pile. So what Merlin does is she can eat a card once she has to tap or sleep, go, you know, rest to do it, but she can eat a card out of either player's graveyard, so banish a card from a graveyard. And if it's a floating memory card, she gets a level counter, which helps. Some spells say pay less if equal to your level. So she's kind of a hindrance on people trying to cheat, I guess, their leveling up and their plays out of their side deck. And I've gone with Wind just because there was some good other stuff that looked fun to do with her. So a lot of enlightenment counters, which is something that every 3 you have, you can remove from your champion and draw a card at fast speed. I thought it was a kind of a joke deck and I was just playing around, but it turns out it's got legs. And it just does a lot of derping. Like it doesn't win quickly, but it can just...
But it doesn't let your opponent win.
It doesn't let your opponent win very quick. And then you just sort of like, oh, I guess I'll get loads of enlightenment counters and draw 7 cards. No, and then
Marnie fully triggered my... just triggered me completely when we first brought that out, because I was just so used to getting to level 3 like fast, and then I was just like, I can't do anything.
Yeah, eating all his memory. So I guess that's always interesting to say. If you're watching this video and you're not yet into Grand Archive, definitely give it a look. And obviously on our website, cardmerchantnelson.co.nz, we have pre-orders up for Alter Edition, which is all of the cards you see in our game will be in that set as well, in those boxes, coming out at the end of April. And there's starter decks as well, $25 each, which seems to be pretty good value. There's chance of these amazing collector rares and stuff.
Yeah.
And it will obviously just help get you kickstarted into the game. And there are singles and stuff around at the moment. It's a bit pricey just due to, you know, supply, but
yeah, it's just the Kickstarter
sets, edition,
which wasn't very
well, but there are budget builds, yeah, which, you know, as well, this kind of is a fairly budget build, I believe. I've, you know, sold off or traded a lot of the better or more expensive cards I would have had in here for people to play their decks. Yeah. So but it operates
shop owner.
It operates pretty well. So we'll give you a run through anyway, see how you feel about it. We'll try and do our best to explain everything we're doing.
Yeah.
And why. I guess read the card is always an important TCG card playing mantra. So we'll read out loud to you what's happening. And very interesting way to start the game too, which you'll see in a second. It's the only game I've played where my opponent, if I go first, doesn't have any hand or anything in play while I have my first turn. So, should we roll to see if starts?
Yes.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah.
Ooh. 10.
Welcome to the channel, and hope you enjoy. We'll have a lot more coming for you.
Oh, lost the roll.
So, talking about what she does, etc., I think she wants to go first, just get her up to level 2 as quick as possible.
Yeah, that's the main advantage of going first, is leveling up faster than your opponent.
Yeah, because you don't draw a card for the turn, which you otherwise each turn draw after you recollect. But yeah, so this is it. Look, first thing I materialize, and you have to on your first turn, a Spirit of Wind. So this costs 0 to materialize, so I don't have to have anything here. On enter, draw 7 cards. There we go.
And there's no mulliganing in this game.
Nope.
So mostly your hands are pretty much always playable, so it doesn't really need a mulligan.
What have we got here? Not a lot.
Yeah. I'll just sit here twiddling my thumbs. Not even any cards to look at or play in with my hand.
I will just play Harness Mana for 0.
It's one of those pesky floating memory cards.
This has floating memory.
But only if you're a mage.
Only if
class
I'm a mage.
Bonus. So a lot of cards have class bonus, which means if you're that class, you get an extra effect. So they're sort of, you can play it in any deck, but
I'll do another one. And then I will play Favorable Winds, which would, if allies I control, which is 0, get +1 defense or health points.
Yeah.
But this has floating memory, so next turn
so
I can
just want it in your grave.
Go to level 1 by banishing this rather than paying with this, because this will come back to my hand.
So you're seeing a pattern here. Floating memory, a lot of people just play floating memory cards that just are easy to put in your graveyard so you can immediately use them. So it's pretty crucial for a lot of strategies to floating memory.
And then I'm going to pay 1 card down to pay 1 cost. Fairy Whisper, Glimpse 3. So if you play Magic, Scry. If you play Fab, Opt. I'm sure there's other ones like it as well in other games. But we're going to look at the top 3. I can put them any top or bottom of my deck. And then I reveal the top card. And if it's a wind element card, I get to put it in my hand.
It's a pretty good start, to be honest.
It's not bad.
Just a lot of cards that draw other cards, essentially.
Oh, a wind element card.
Well, what is
put it in my hand.
It's a pretty good card, too. I think. Wind Rider.
Yeah, we'll see her soon. Your turn, my friend.
All right, well,
so note that there I can't attack James. If I'd had an ally, he has no champion in play for me to deal damage
to. There's nothing
to
attack.
Yeah.
So going second, you get the first draw phase, and you also get the first attack. Not that either of our decks attack very much, but well, yours kind of does. Alright, draw for turn.
I've
8 cards in my hand.
Delicious.
Decisions.
So we've got a water and wind battle here.
Alright, I'm going to Idle Thoughts. This is a floating memory card. Let's me look at the top 4 cards, and I can put them back on top in any order.
So it's not quite Glimpse. Glimpse is top or bottom. This one's just rearranging the top four and leaving them all on top. And as James says, floating memory. So he's going to be able to use that to
level up.
Yeah,
I'm going to want to use that pretty soon.
Pretty quick.
Okay, I guess I'll put them like that. And then I've got a Scry the Skies. Ooh. This just lets me glimpse equal to my level, which is currently zero. So I don't get to look, but I get to put a card into my memory from the top of my deck. So that goes there. And then we're going to play... maybe I could do that again. Yeah, I'll do another one.
Ooh.
So that one goes in memory as well. And then we'll play a Library Witch.
Oh.
So I got to use my whole hand.
Tell us about Library Witch, James.
Library Witch instills her love for reading in aspiring students.
I bet she does. She's a zero attack, so luckily we're going to take damage.
One health intercept, which means if my champion is attacked and this ally is awake, I can redirect that attack to this ally. So it basically helped prevent a bit of damage to my life total. Like a blocker,
kind of.
Yeah, or taunt, like in Hearthstone.
Yeah.
But it only works against my leader. I can't protect my other allies. And when it dies, I draw a card.
That's so handy.
Prevent damage and draw cards.
Seems a good card.
Card draw's good, turns out, in card games.
I may have one of those in my deck.
Yeah.
All right, is that your turn?
That's my turn.
Alrighty, so start of turn, we're going to materialize. So I would like to play a level 1 champion onto my level 0. This is Rai Spellcrafter. He costs me 1, which would come from here, however... Floating memory. So let's banish this one card to pay this one cost. When he enters, put 2 enlightenment counters on him. So those were the ones I mentioned before. Every 3 I have can be removed to draw a card. And then we recollect here. So take my memory back up. My other card's there. And I'm going to draw for the turn. And I have that card, which I guess I knew I had. Yeah, Library Witch is quite the annoying card, not gonna lie.
Usually not good against mages, but I think you've got.
So this is a 1 attack, 1 defense. It's got stealth, so units with stealth can't be attacked. So this can't be attacked or targeted by the attacks of James's champion or allies unless they have a keyword called True Sight. So she's all stealthy and she can only be hit with True Sight. And a class bonus. So this is an ally mage human. So a lot of cards have class bonus, which just means if their type matches your champion type, which I'm a mage human, so I get this extra ability. At the beginning of my recollection phase, I can return this to my hand, and if I do, put an enlightenment counter on my champion.
Mm.
As we said, they can attack straight away, so I'm just going to attack Library Witch.
Just going to do it.
Directly.
Oof.
Intercept that Library Witch.
Oh, I can't. Well, that's right. I kind of want Library Witch to die anyway, so I just have my card.
Yeah.
I have my card now.
So that's good, and that's all I can do. So it's your turn, Eddie.
Alright. I know that your champion likes to eat floating memory, so for my recollection, I'm going to level up to my level 1 Zander. Using my floating memory, going into banish. And Zander says, when he enters, I can glimpse 2. So I'll see what's on top.
So glimpsing is top or bottom?
Top or bottom. Do I want these? I think I've actually got heaps of those cards already, so I don't need them. I want to find better cards than that. And he gets a preparation counter. Preparation counters don't do anything by themselves, but certain cards care about using preparation counters to give them extra effects. So,
yeah. So certain cards and actions you play will be boosted if you have prep counters to use. Yeah.
Yeah. So cool. We're going to draw for turn. Oh, yeah. I'll play out another Library Witch.
Oh my goodness. This is not good times for me.
No, I want to play this. I think I will. Set the traps. This one says, target player puts two cards from their deck into their graveyard, and I get a preparation counter. So I'm actually going to... I'm going to target myself, I think. Although it might give you more fuel. I usually want to target myself to try and get Floating Memory in the graveyard. But if I do that, you're just going to use it. I think I will, just in case something good. Oh, now I wish I hadn't. I lost a Lightweaver's Assault.
And?
And another Set the Traps, which I'm not too sad about. But yeah, that's all right. I'm just going to pass back.
Alright. Untap first,
yeah.
Pretty sure. And yeah. Then materialize. So, luckily, this is a mage spell that has class bonus Floating Memory. I played two of them on turn one, so they're going to go away to get my Merlin Memory Thief into play.
Sweet.
And then, that's still my grave. And then, do I want an Enlightenment counter? Sure. So, beginning of Recollection, I'm going to return this to my hand and gain an Enlightenment counter. Recollect, draw a card, and bolt your uncle. Interesting. We're just gonna get stuck in here with some double Windrider mages.
What the heck?
Kill this.
Kill the witch.
Yep.
Sure. I'll take that.
One at you.
Yep, so that's first damage. So
yay, first blood.
One counter.
Alright, your turn, my friend.
Alright.
So, interestingly here, now we've talked about Floating Memory and everything else, James doesn't have any at the moment. So, if he wants to level up to two like I did, he has to lose two cards from his hand, effectively.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting balance.
I think I have to.
Alright, he's doing it. So these get banished at random.
I'm pick at random. I need a dice.
Yeah, fair enough. Always so feels bad when your opponent chooses the worst cards.
Yeah, exactly. I'll do one up to four, and if I roll five or six, I'll just reroll.
Yeah.
Ooh. Oh. One.
Yep.
So that's a water barrier gone, and one, two, four, six.
Yep.
One. Glacial Guidance is gone.
Alright.
It's all good.
So they get banished.
They're banished
as well, not to graveyard yet.
And then I draw for turn. And Zander level 2 says, as long as he's attacking a rested unit, he gets plus 1 attack.
Hmm.
I think we can go strategic planning, because we want to see if we can find some good cards on top. That's a glimpse 2 and put a preparation counter on my leader. What if those cards aren't super useful? I mean, they're good. I guess I could use them next turn.
So
I'll put one on top and one on bottom.
Cool.
Yeah.
And you get a prep.
And I'm up to three preparations.
Cool.
And I'm gonna pass. Oh my god.
Materialize. So I'm gonna look at my pile now. I've got some stuff that costs one, so I'd have to banish from here at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
I've got stuff that costs zero. So I think our favorite card to play from here is this Excalibur.
Oh no.
For zero. And it says, it's a mage sword, funnily enough, and it says class bonus. On enter, choose a player. That player gains control of Excalibur. Why would I give my weapon away? With a weapon, you can use it. Its first number used with your hero attacks for one, this sword. And the shield is durability counters for weapons. So each time you successfully deal damage with this attack, you remove one of them. And when the last one comes off, it gets banished. So they're only always temporary, like they wear out, which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
The reason I'm giving this to James is whenever you control this card, whenever you materialize a card, it deals 2 damage to you. So, or to your champion.
So I get it.
So I give it to James kindly and say, hey mate, if you want to get some more out of here, you're going to take some damage. And then at start of recollection, I'll bring both of these back to my hand.
Okay.
And get 2 enlightenment, 1 each. Recollect and draw a card.
Oh, Excalibur. You're so mean.
You're so good. And I think we're just gonna play this card. So this says 8 cost, however it's efficiency. It costs level less to activate. So I'm level 2.
Yeah.
So it's going to cost me 6. 8 minus 2 is 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All go down.
Just one turn.
And put 5 enlightenment counters on my champion. So I go up to 10. So I'm effectively looking at 3 draw cards max and 1 left over if I want to. And I'm going to say, nice. Your turn.
That's all you got. All right.
All I've got. Giving you 2 damage and getting...
Yeah, well, I kind of have to materialize, otherwise I'm going to fall too far behind. So I'm going to take my 2 damage.
Yay.
Get a Crusader Ring, Grand Crusader's Ring. This is a...
Holy Grail.
The Holy Grail.
Of this game.
Yeah, it's a what people call a staple. You draw a card by banishing it, and you can only have 1 of it in your deck. Well, you can only have 1 of it. A divine relic card in
So this is the only divine relic at the moment, but this is sort of, I think it ties into the lore and the story a bit, it was the ring given to the warriors and Camelot and stuff,
yeah,
something like this. But in the future it just suggests they'll have other divine relics, and you can only choose 1 card that is a divine relic to have in your deck. But yeah, as we were saying, drawing cards are a premium. This costs James nothing to put out, and it just gives him an extra card with no condition.
Exactly. Well, first things first, I need to attack with this Excalibur so that I get rid of it.
Yeah, because once those durability counters come off...
So I attack you for 1.
I take 1 damage.
And then I will play this Intrepid Highwayman.
Ooh. Nasty.
3 down. Yep, so this one's a 1/1/2. 1 attack, 2 health. As long as it's retaliating, it gets +3 attack, so it can kill some big stuff. And it's got intercept, so it's a good blocker as well.
And class
bonus floating memory, so some potential fuel for you.
Imagine that.
I'm going to pass the turn, I think, at that point.
Alright, I'm going to look to materialize here. So it's getting interesting. I think here we kind of just want to keep finding more cards to try and get some more floating memory, because each time she eats a card, banishes a card from a grave that has floating memory, she's going up a level.
Yeah.
And as you saw from that card, if I'm level 7, this would have cost me 1. And then I could have 5 other cards to do stuff with.
Yeah.
So I'm going to play this 0. Sort of like James's ring. It can draw me a card. However, this is not a Grand Crusader ring. So I cannot remove enlightened counters from my champion to pay for costs while this is in play. If I banish it, draw a card, but I can only do that if I have 6 or more enlightenment counters. So that's why I play it now, because I can do that. I recollect, draw a card. Oh, my favorite card. So Choices. We will play this again.
It's back.
Back for more. And we'll attack James's intrepid highwayman because it's annoying us. So damage stays on an ally for the turn.
Yeah, they go away end of turn.
Yeah, so you can pile up multiple things.
So since you're attacking, I can retaliate.
Alright.
So I'm going to deal one damage to your mage.
You mean it. So. Well, it does four.
Yeah, it does four, but yeah, it only needs to do one. My mage and this has minus
one damage
minus
on it.
One damage. Just got one damage on it. One health left.
One health.
Then I'll play Zephyr Assistant. So this has class bonus. It's a mage human. On enter, put an enlightenment counter on my dude.
True.
And on leave, so if it comes back to my hand, if it dies, if it gets banished anywhere, I get an enlightenment counter. So I'll attack. Now this is rested. It can't retaliate and destroy this. So.
Alright, so that's the final death damage. That's in there.
And then I will pass the turn to you, James.
Alright. Well, I'm gonna untap.
Mm-hmm.
And then materialize. I'm gonna level up.
Oh, I get to eat that, don't I?
Are you gonna do it now? Yeah, before I level up?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was surprised you were going to leave
me. Yeah, sorry, I forgot about that. That was part of the point.
I was like, oh, I'm going to keep it hard in my...
No, we're definitely doing that. That was, yeah, we've been building up to it. It took so long, I almost forgot.
Sorry. I almost got away with it.
You almost got...
Okay, I'll use my whole memory, because I've got three memory.
Oh, my goodness. All right.
So I'll banish all these cards, good cards, but I don't need them. And I'm now Luxem. Oh, and I take two damage, because I materialize.
Yay.
My Zander and draw for turn. Okay, so I'm gonna draw with Crusader Ring as well.
Nice. Get that card stock.
Find
back up.
Some good stuff. Okay, let's have a think here. I'm gonna play Uncover the Plot. So I'm going to place my memory down, and this says cost 2. Target player reveals all cards in their memory, and I draw a card and get 2 preparation counters. So I'm going to reveal my memory, and I'm going to reveal Gleaming Cut. And then I'll just do my card draw and my counters. So Gleaming Cut says when it's revealed from memory, I banish it and draw 2 cards.
Nice.
So draw.
So you just went from like... What,
no
two
cards,
cards? One
lots
or two,
of cards.
And now you're like 5 or 6 again. Yeah. Strong.
Alright, and then I better do my attacks. So I'll attack. I also forgot, because I revealed. Oh, I didn't reveal any. No, I didn't do Xander's ability because I had no memory.
Yep.
I'm going to attack your leader for 2 because your leader is rested and. So champions inherit the effects of their previous levels, so they stick around. Ooh. So I still have level 2 Xander's plus 1 to rested units.
Rested units, yep, nice.
So attack for 2 with my Excalibur that you so graciously gave me. And I'm going to put my memory back face down. Do I want to play anything else is the question. I don't think I do. Don't think I do. So I'm just gonna pass, I think. Let's have a think about this. That's tricky.
So we've seen a few turns here, so one big challenge. I guess, at least for myself, is with this game, is the 2 different costs. and the fact there's a fair amount of like looking at the top of your deck and putting these cards face down, so remembering what's here.
Yeah,
you are allowed to look, but you know, you want to remember what's here if you've readjusted this, and the fact that you're paying different costs for these cards and these cards, there's quite a lot going on.
I think I do really want to get rid of the Zephyr Assistant, because I think you can abuse its on leave ability. So I just want to get it out of there as soon as possible. I'm going to play my Highwayman and attack your assistant.
Yeah. So before damage, once he's declared that attack, I have this card that has fast, and it says cost 3, mage spell, class bonus, I'm a mage, efficiency, it costs less equal to my level, so the 3 is minus 3 is 0 as a player. Return an ally to its owner's hand. So I'm going to return my Zephyr, meaning that the attack's just negated.
Doesn't happen.
And remember, this says when it leaves play, I get an enlightenment counter.
Rough. That's pretty good.
Yeah, added those in recently. Nice. That'd be nice. Interestingly, this deck, I put all this returning allies to hand as a protective measure, defensive, and I realized with some of my cards like this, it can be used on my side just useful. As much. So, yeah.
Sweet. Well, that's all I got. So it's your turn. It's my memory. Yeah.
So.
What am I going to get next turn?
Untap.
There's a lot of thinking ahead in this game and what to materialize and what to put in your memory just in case you don't want to get rid of stuff.
I'll just get this out. So this is another 0 to play one. This says whenever an ally I control dies while it's not my turn. So if James had done that and it had died, I could banish this and draw a card. So it's another draw card, but it's conditional to one of my allies dying on James's turn. Recollect, and then draw for the turn. Zephyr Assistant's coming back. So enter, get an enlightenment counter, attack James for 1.
Okay. Take the 1.
Then we're going to banish this mana limiter. Long as I have 6 or more enlightened, draw a card. Then, now this is gone, I can use enlightenment counters. So I'm going to use some now. So every remove 3, draw a card. So I'll go down to 10 to draw a card. And I will place down this Azian Protector, which costs 4, which is my last cards currently in my hand.
Nice.
And this says when it says intercept, so that's what James has explained, same as this. If he attacks my champion, I can rest it I can just block and rest to retaliate, but if it's awake. But the other thing is on enter, return target ally I control to its owner's hand. So when this leaves, I get an enlightenment counter.
Oh,
so now this can attack, and it's going to attack for 3 directly at this while it's rested, so it can't retaliate.
Oh man, I got completely outplayed playing that turn.
I'm going to tap Merlin and eat this floating memory from his graveyard. And pass to you.
I got ruined that turn. My Highwayman didn't get to retaliate on your protector. I didn't get to even get to kill your stupid.
It was rough. I had to do something in response to your draw 4 or 5 card comeback.
Oh, you can draw like 4 cards whenever you want, so that's not good for me. I think I need to get this map out. So this is a Luxera's map, which says it's an ultra rare, so pretty good card, hopefully. It costs 1 usually, but because I'm class bonus assassin, I can play it for free. And enters rested, but when it untaps, I get to banish it and search my deck for any card and put it in my memory.
Which, as you've shown with your revealing special secrets.
Yep. Pretty good. I also get to reveal my memory. There's no Luxem in there, unfortunately, though.
Bugger. All right.
Just got a bunch of random stuff. Hopefully I draw a good card.
So you right take now. 2 damage as well.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Materializing with the
dang it
Excalibur.
Oh, I actually drew the exact card I wanted.
Drown cut?
Yeah. Thankfully. So
currently here he can deal 2 damage to this, and he really wants to deal 4 to it, I think.
Yeah. So it's got a floating memory, which is something I really don't want to put in my grave, but I guess we can put this card back. So yeah, I'm going to play Drown Cut. It's an attack. Mm-hmm. So you can combine attack cards with an attack with a weapon.
Yeah, one of each, right?
Maybe yeah, one of each. Yeah. One attack with one weapon.
Yeah.
And it basically gives its 2 attack to my Excalibur. And because I'm attacking a rested unit, which is the Protector, it's 1 plus 2 plus 1 is 4. Kill cool. your Protector.
So as a fast effect, I can choose to try and draw an answer.
Please don't draw an answer.
So I'm going to remove 3 and see what I get. And then I'll remove another 3 and see what I get.
There's so many cards that blow me out here, I think.
And I'll do one more, just for fun.
Just for fun. What are the chances?
Oh! Literally 1 card off. So you get a hit. So 4 damage is dealt. And
thank God.
Trigger this. So yep. I'm going to banish the amulet, which says when a creature ally dies on not my turn, banish this to draw.
Perfect. Oh, and that's the last counter on my Excalibur used up. So good job. Goodbye.
No more damage for free for me.
And that's my turn done.
Alright. So, because I'm slightly forgetful, I'm just going to tap Merlin at the start of my recollection. Can I have material? Oh, I don't know. I can't do it in the material.
The first opportunity is recollection.
Recollection, okay. I'll materialize. Materialize. What do we get? I think we'll just get this Endurance Scepter. Maybe. So this is a scepter, and I can tap it at slow speed, so only in my turn. Remove 1 Enlightened counter to deal 1 damage to target unit, so it can be an ally or James's champion. And then recollection, start a recollection, I get a chance to do a thing. So I'm going to tap Merlin and banish this. She gains a level. Sure. And I get my cards and I draw and get back to work.
Yes, yeah, so I'm going to try to avoid putting floating memory in my graveyard, but that was just necessary evil, getting that drown cut. But I would have felt extremely salty if you had found a favorable winds or anything else that has trickery from wind. Yep. That would have prevented that protector dying.
So idle thoughts, I'll look at the top 4. This is quite a staple card. Everyone likes to play it.
Yep, it's a pretty strong card. Thankfully it's common, so pretty easy to find.
Then I shall
how do I get out of this situation?
Play my mate, Zephyr Assistant. Get an enlightened counter.
Oh,
she's attack back. For 1.
She's a pretty
she's back at it, eh? And then we'll get old mate Azim Protector. Oh. So when he enters, return this. Get an enlightened counter.
Yep.
Attack for three.
Yeah, I'll just take your three, I think.
And play Fairy Whispers, so glimpse three, reveal a wind, and if I do, put it in my hand.
Oh, not another one.
And then last card, I'll play this for one. So Scry the Skies becomes quite good for me in later in the game, because this is level, glimpse equal to level, I'm level five. So I get to look at five, put any at top or bottom. And then and then to end my turn, I'll tap my scepter and remove an enlightened counter to deal you one damage.
Ouch.
Your turn.
Got me halfway, dude.
I'm trying.
Alright. Got no cards in your hand. It's potentially good. I think I have to get... I'm going to get out a Poison Dagger. Which comes in rested, but I can use it to deal a damage to any unit, and that unit... until for the rest of the turn, that unit, if it takes damage, takes that much plus one.
Mm-hmm.
That's quite good for making my combo at the end of the game deal a bit more damage.
Mm-hmm.
Recollect, I reveal you a border, so that's not very useful for anything, but drawing cards. I may need to draw some good cards soon. Question is, what do I want to put in my memory with this map? It's the struggle with this matchup is I need to build my hand back up to being a fit, like, you know. You've got 10 cards or something in your hand, whereas I only have 5.
Yep.
I'm getting back up to that critical amount is difficult.
So, the other...
I'm just going to break the map now, because I really should, and just decide while I search.
Yeah.
It's probably not...
I guess, of all the classes, Mage tends to... get the most cards generally, or I guess easier, just because they have the enlightened, they get more enlightened, they get enlightened encounters naturally. Rye is the main mage character,
do that,
and he can get them more as he levels up as well. But the downside is they don't attack very much with weapons and things as well. Yeah, and
I think I'm gonna choose this card. Otherwise, maybe I could do. I just feel like I'm quite far away from ending this game, so I might have to just plan for a long game and hopefully I can survive a bit longer.
Alright.
So, yep, I'm just gonna put this card in my memory and pass the turn.
Cards in hand?
Four, five.
Five. Okay. Untap. Look at my materialize options. Channeling Stone costs me one. I'll banish this floating memory card to pay. I can banish this. The next card I activate, which means play, this turn costs two less. Bad. It's surprisingly good at activating big allies that attack. I'm going to play a Zephyr Assistant, gain an Enlightenment Catalyst.
Yep.
Attack you for one.
Yep. Take one.
Then I'll attack you for three.
Yep. I'll allow it.
And then... I'll play another Zephyr Assistant, gain another Enlightenment character, and attack you for one.
Yep. I'm getting surprisingly low.
And then I'll ping you for one damage.
Pingers.
Your turn.
Alright. My turn. I'll materialize this curved dagger. That one says as long as it's attacking an ally, it gets plus one, so its base attack is one. So it can attack an ally for two, which is nice. Materialize relic collection. I'm gonna reveal my Lightweaver's Assault, which is gonna deal two damage to something. I'm gonna choose your protector to deal two damage to. So it's got two damage marks on it. And I draw for turn. And I'm gonna play. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot, because it hasn't come up yet. Xander's effect says, when I reveal a Luxem card, you have to put one of your cards in from hand into memory.
That is true. So, I guess on that note, I will draw a card at fast speed.
Yep, you can do that.
Can I?
Yep.
And I will... Scattering Gusts as a fast card. So, suppress two target allies. To suppress an ally, banish and return it to the field under its owner's control at the beginning of the next end. At the beginning of the next end phase, so the end of your turn, they come back.
Right.
So I'll banish these two.
Well, hold on.
Okay.
In response.
Okay.
I have an effect.
Yep.
Revitalizing Cleanse.
Oh,
so that means I can re-reveal my memory.
Yeah,
and I gain X life, where X is the amount of water element revealed, and I draw
a
card.
Do you re-reveal this though?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, because it basically revealing is that, but I sort of left it up for remembering purposes.
Yeah, sure, that's true. Yeah.
So I'm revealing now.
Yeah.
Two more damage to your protector. Oh,
he's done it.
And I gain. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Because I've got five water in my memory.
Okay.
And I draw.
And this, when I play a class bonus, get an enlightenment count. And then resolve the rest. This comes out.
You can return that one still.
It left play to be suppressed because it's banished.
Yep.
And so it gave me that.
Yep. And then I'm going to finish recollecting. So I get all these cards back.
Oh my goodness. That was pretty nice. So yeah. That one there,
actually,
right? Fast
that?
Speed.
Yeah. Wait, actually, could I have done that? I think I actually did that wrong.
Why?
Because I think I drawn for turn already. So we might have to rewind.
Oh, rewind, alright, in the integrity of the game.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I've just realized that I think I actually drew
before.
A card,
yeah,
and then you were like, oh, I have an effect.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
So, yeah, I didn't play this.
Sorry, T. Do you remember what you drew?
Yeah, I've put them back.
Okay, cool.
So I didn't draw that. And we're going back. We've rewound. So that's resolving. And it's returning both to your banish.
Yeah, and I've already gained the those. So these both get banished. Yeah. And they'll come back at the turn.
Yeah. All right. So we've done that. We're back. We're back where we started. That's fine. It's kind of annoying.
Oh, Zephyr Assistant.
Yeah, it's annoying. I think I'm just going to attack your Zephyr Assistant.
Mm-hmm.
Get it out of here for three, because I've got Poison Dagger and
Zander's. Should I try and luck myself out of death?
Lux. One sack. Yep.
All right. Remove three Enlightenment counters. There's one card, and it's not that card, which I knew because I put them there. Silly me. This leaves play, and I get one back.
I didn't. Oh, yes. I forgot to put my life back to where it was before I revitalizing cleansed.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna pass the turn.
So in turn, end of your turn, these come back to play. So I will trigger that end this in. Like, how would that work, guys? I'll trigger this first to enter first.
Yeah.
And then I'll trigger this.
Yeah.
To rebounce this back.
Yeah.
And get another one.
Yep.
Yep.
Too much
enlightenment counters and drawing and things.
I wonder if I do stuff on. I think I might do stuff now before you put your hand back as well.
Yes, yep. So I have two cards in
the Yep. So.
Oh, you got another light weaver.
That'll be spicy. I think what I do is I play the cleanse now in my end step.
Yep.
So reveal just one light weaver, so that's two damage. I might as well just do it to you because nothing better to do, and I gain four.
Yeah,
and I draw a card.
Yeah,
and then I'm going to play Fishing Accident
on
your ASEAN Protector. I'm going to use its prepare effect, so to prepare it I have to remove two preparation counters and it gains the effect. Normally it's rest target ally, but since I've prepared, it says put that ally on the bottom of its owner's deck instead. Wowza.
So I'll try this again. Remove three. Is it still in your end step?
It's still in my end step, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, this dagger's gone because I used it to attack your fairy thing. Hopefully it resolves the spell. No.
I'll banish this to make a spell cost two less. Two cards equals four. I'll scatter gust again. Although, does that have to return it to my hand? Oh, well. I'll suppress. Does it say two or up to two?
Beginning of the next end phase. Up to two. So you can do it. Yep.
But it won't come back
until... It won't come back until end of your turn. Because it's this. We're in my end phase, so the next end phase is your end phase.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty annoying. Continue.
It's one little neck. Annoying.
Yeah. Among other things.
No floating memory. Don't think I have any. So we're going to play a zero Crusader Ring. Recollect, draw a card, and we're just gonna show James we're serious about game.
That was a pretty intense stack back last turn. No.
Yeah, this is like the best game we've ever had, I feel, yeah, like, in terms of just intricacies.
Interacting. But you're always like, coming on top, though. That's the problem.
It's huge. Just my changes I made. This is a giant gorilla that's 4 cost, and it says Pride 5. He won't obey, so he won't attack or retaliate or anything, unless my level is 5. Pride 5, so my level is 5 or higher.
Crazy.
Class bonus, he would get extra 2 attack and health, but that's for Tamer, and I'm a wizard, so a mage. So he's only 4-4.
No.
Attack you for 4.
All right. Take it.
Zephyr Assistant.
Yep.
Get an Enlightenment counter. Attack you for 1.
Yep.
Library Witch.
Oh. That's alright, actually. I don't care too much.
I'll tap this to remove and deal you 1.
Yeah.
And at the end step, this will come back. And I'll bounce this back to my hand, get an Enlightenment counter, and say your turn.
Oh, this is not good for me. I think I have to materialize here. I'm going to lose a card from hand, but hopefully it's not the one, that one card that everyone, that I love the most. So that's 6
the Lightweaver's.
The Lightweaver's. If I lose
1-6.
Yeah, 1-6.
Don't
yeah.
lose the Lightweaver's,
that's
Jess.
1, that's 6.
All right. Good luck.
Oh.
Oh, no! Welcome to the random aspect of this game. Eh? That's the one.
That was my last glimmer of light hope.
That's why people like floating memory. So they don't
have someone won't let me have it. So I'm going to reveal all these water cards.
It's Merlin's fault, not mine.
No, it's yours.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're telling Merlin what to do.
Okay. I didn't print that ability.
I don't even know if I want to play any of these cards because they don't have floating memory. So I got this Assassin's Ripper. So the good thing about this is it's a big weapon. So if I remove, it's got 1 base attack, but if I remove a preparation counter from my hero or leader, champion, whatever they're called, I can get +2.
Ooh.
So I'm going to do that. I go down to 2 preparation counters, which means I can attack your silverback for 4 damage.
That's pretty good. Here's gold.
Oh my god, I finally managed to clear a creature from the board properly. And this only has 1 durability left. And then I suppose I will play Intrepid Highwayman. Cost 3. And pass the turn, and hopefully that can help deal with your protector.
Hopefully. I'll play Crystal of Empowerment, which I can banish, and my champion gets +2 level for that turn. Recollect, draw a card. Going to make the turn a bit easier, I think, to try and figure out what to do. So banish my ring and draw 1 card. Two down to play Swift Recruit. And he is going to come in and attack Highwayman directly for 1.
Okay. He's got 1 left.
play this swift recruit.
Okay.
And attack your highwayman for one.
How many cards do you have left in hand?
Five.
It's worth trying this, but I'm gonna try. I'm gonna play this Glacial Guidance. It might actually be worth just. I could either rest an ally or rest an attacking ally, or if I target an attacking ally, it ends the combat. So that would stop the damage to my Highwayman. But I feel like you might just have another one attack. Ally in hand, so maybe I just rest your protector so it can't attack for the rest of the turn.
That's quite good. Yep.
And I let my Highwayman die.
You're not going to retaliate.
I guess so. Yeah, I probably should.
Because that's floating memory, so yeah. The reason, I guess, you would.
Usually you don't want to put floating memory cards, but I am quite low on life, so putting allies into grave is probably. For the best.
I'll tap Merlin and banish that.
Banish my floating memory card.
Yeah, go up a little. Four in hand. I'm going to put down four. And play this as in protector, bouncing this one.
What the heck? Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess you can just play it next turn.
Attack you for three.
Yep.
And then tap this and remove my last enlightenment
card. Oh, yeah. You got me. I'm at 25.
I almost missed it, but it's always sitting there. Wow. Wind is bouncy. So much bouncing around. But yeah, good budget deck, this one.
Yeah.
And if you're someone who likes annoying your opponents, but also I think no one really suspects that this deck will do that much when they see some of your stuff, so.
Yeah, well, the fact that I think its main strength is that you force your opponent to banish their memory to level up and do other things, and then you're drawing X amount of cards additionally because of all your enlightened counters, and then you basically just outcard your opponent.
Yeah,
because most of your cards are pretty low, are reasonably low quality, apart from the protectors. I'd say those are pretty big beat sticks, and your monkey is pretty big.
Yeah, this but most was of the a other ones. New addition.
Did I suggest that, or was it
James?
Figured that out?
James and another player, Shannon, and myself, I think, all
recognized the power of the monkey.
Yeah, because this is a tamer card, and a lot of the tamer allies are large, but they have this pride mechanic, so you have to get her level up. But we were like, hang on, Merlin just gets to level 5 plus pretty quick. So. Yeah. There's two of this in there, because before this, the protector was doing a large amount of the ending the games. So having two more, even one extra attack for the same cost as well, just seems nice. So a card, if you want to try this deck out and you've got some cards, or you've got friends who open cards, or when the Alter Edition comes out actually in stores in the end of April. One card I do believe is really good in here that I'll try and fit back in when the cards come available is called Beseech the Winds. Yep. It's a wind element card that's the only type in the game that allows you to materialize twice in one turn. So it costs three to play it, and it just says you may materialize a card. So you still have to pay the cost, but it just means that with this Merlin being so crucial with eating like memory, floating memory, I think, you can get to Merlin by your second turn if you're playing that card.
Yeah,
which is worth it. Because yeah.
Because that's when most of the floating memory is used up on like the first couple of turns.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh. Normally you'd play a couple more like best of three game, but I think we've spent a long time explaining each thing, and it's been a quite long video already. But suffice to say, it's a pretty bad matchup for me round one. So I bring in a lot of cards from my sideboard.
But hopefully it looks fun, and don't be deterred by the fact that it is a long video. Of course, you understand we want to explain what's actually happening with a new game. But yeah, and at the start, to be fair, you know, as we said, there's a lot to think about. So I think, I know locally in our store we've had, three hobbies a week for the last couple of weeks. And, you know, a lot of the games are just like going for a long time. We're not timing matches as long as no one needs to leave, but you know, it is taking people longer. But once you've had about, I don't know, a dozen reps or so with your deck, you can definitely finish a best of three in about 45-50 minutes. For sure,
definitely, especially if you're playing against Rai.
He's just like, it's just like combo
kills.
He's almost like a more proactive version of this deck in a way. But thank you so much for watching. Hopefully you like the look of this grand archive at a first glance, if you haven't seen it already. And again, thanks for tuning in to our first official video with some content. Thank you, James, for getting it all sorted. Wicked. Like and subscribe. Cheers.
Card Merchant Nelson hosts your favorite card games like Magic, Pokemon, Flesh and Blood, and more. Check out our online store for singles, sealed product, events, and accessories, and start playing today.